those who had very seriously opposed it. So the monopolization of memory of the early Reformation by Protestants had made some surmise that the Reformation had been carried out spontaneously and had been met with support from the start. It was an easy process, and therefore they had left behind it. This was not the Catholic view. So Catholics' mapping of their ancestors' sufferings and their sacrifices for the Catholic Church wasn't the way to undermine the idea that this was an easy process. So as Schellnauer stated, the Reformation had been contested and forced upon an unwilling the mean opinion the ancient Catholic clergy had of this pretended Reformation when first it began to appear in England. So, saying this is not and that's why I call these collections counter-archives. They were created for parallel archives which filled in the silences of Protestant archives, and they are very much bent on countering the allegations made in the So the compilations provided a very constructive answer. They built on the documentary evidence of Catholic sufferings and sacrifice and ensured that their findings were So they're not just denying what others get from the Protestant archives, they try to build up together the material to support their findings. And in the process of ensuring their side of the story does not get omitted from the historical record, what is noticeable is that these counter-archives make the minorities the protagonists of their own story. So we have learned to read archives of the powerful against the grain, so to discern the voices of those not in power. Yet the problem with that methodology, however crucial and laudatory it is in and of itself, still remains that we encounter those out of power only in relation to those in power, only as submissive and only as dictated by the practice of that interaction laid out by others, not on their own terms, not on their own ground, not in their own story. And so many dispossessed therefore created those own collections for their own actions in context of their own story, which helped to justify and explain their actions in story, So those collections restore some of the agency and therefore humanity to the individuals of that minority, for them no longer justified by their encounter with power. And so in the case of of English Catholics, that process of making them the protagonists of those counter archives is clear in how they highlight that English Catholics' actions are witnessing to the truth of the Catholic So witnessing is a very effective term, and the Oxford English Dictionary gives many definitions, including formally attesting or giving evidence, experienced by personal observation, be associated with it. What they all have in common is the same cold or a bad flu from them to the church. That biblical reference actually underscores that role of the observable, the outer action, to make manifest that image. Okay, but importantly, in those compilations by these Catholic collectors, they write the stories of the Catholic themselves, and they are the acts of stubborn persistence, not of passive submission of Catholic victims. So Catholics were depicted as heroes who took charge of their faith in defense of their faith. So minority in this case definitely is not equal victim, and they would not have appreciated that kind of knowledge of that a victim was sort of sacrificed on for someone else's and the collectors very much highlight that agency, the attempt of shaping their own reputation. So highlighting the typical thing of how they patiently bore their suffering. We have the Constantia in Mars again, these sort of quote throughout the ages, and that is again highlighting how people suffering act themselves, they need to turn to how they sit on that ship. And they do not so Melville's collections of Margaret's accounts and the build his argument that Catholics had approached the Reformation from the time of faith by the sufferings made those direct manifestations of their steadfastness and their beliefs. So not satisfied with their suffering and with their having showed their dislike for his novelties by verbal protestation only, they generously sacrificed all their worldly advantages rather than conform to this need to change his religion. So in Melville's compilation, those martyr sacrifices were not only attempting to practice the recognition, but the pain they were willing to suffer showed their strong conviction to the truth of the Christ. So they sacrificed for their gifts. So we need to recognize that people did record those actions as brave acts of defiance because that agenda shaped what was included and thus preserved for posterity. That matters because it highlights how these collectors were also meant to provide support and inspiration. They were exemplary stories and they were intended to further galvanize their community. So for these collectors were meant to be inspiration and to further support their Catholicism and preservation of the Catholic community. And so counter-archives trace that other voice of the past, the opinions not taken, the thus far unrealized very generative. They're passing on information, they were passing on information, but they were also passing on motivations, encouragement, examples to live up to. And that's where I articulate that role of discrimination in motivating actions of a contemporary. So his account of the martyrdom in his exile, in his suffering, clearly show what these men's opinions was of the contemporary revolution, and therefore what ought to be ours. And so that encapsulates that kind of agenda of those revolutions of the deeds, which make their internal opinions visible, and those undeniable deeds that should guide in peace. But that they were remembered, and that they were the base, the memory of those deeds, were possibly passed on and possibly inspired people, was of crucial importance. Because, here, this is Richard Chaloner, who published lots of the accounts in the Ancient so he added that. Well, when he was describing the line of the Benedictine of Vano and he added that the seat of his missionary labors was in the native country of Lancashire, where certain missionaries were up to my case in Yorkshire. His memory is held in great esteem to this day by the Catholics of that county, for his great zeal in the conversion of souls and his comparative piety in his life and conversation. So Chaloner is therefore to report on the oral traditions and the rituals of the early 18th century. But that mattered because this was a way of establishing that people were remembering, that people were bearing witness to that martyrdom and tradition, these miracles and these meetings. And that string of witnesses was important for the record of the martyr, and perhaps even as important as the record of the martyr's death itself. For a martyr's life and a martyr's afterlife were all witnessed to divine truth, and the truth of the Catholic cause in this case. And in the process, the records of celebration of martyrs were testimony to one of the very dearest signs of the martyr's veracity, their commemoration. So, in kind of circle reasoning, the record collections both show that memory was held in return, and commemoration became proof of truthfulness in and of itself. So the fact that miracles of events were commemorated by Christians became proof of the reality and purpose. And interestingly, when you go through the documents of so lots of these martyrs were canonized in the 20th century, when you go through the discussion in the 19th century in Rome, they look for canon theory, the fame of the martyr, and they use these collections, and it's these collections that are used to prove that people were so the compilations became what Virginia Rangberg has called, in a recent article on Steinbach, archives of faith. So the compilations preserve not